So, I don't know if you've noticed, but these low-carb diets are still very popular, aren't they? People are cutting out bread from their diets. Are you all following that still? It still seems to be a trend. In some very progressive societies, the gluten in bread has almost become like a swear word. And people don't even know what gluten is. But everything must be gluten-free. I don't know what it is, but it mustn't be in that cereal. It mustn't be in that bread. People are terrified of gluten. In fact, I've heard that in places like Los Angeles, in these very progressive societies, you can actually rob a bank with a bagel in your hand. Here's the thing. If you cut out carbs, you cut out bread, you'll start to crave it. And there are a lot of people out there craving freshly baked bread, I can promise you that. And I'm not here this evening to give you dietary advice. I'm not a dietitian. I'm not going to tell you the pros and cons of Banting and the Atkins diet and this diet and that diet. It's not my field, no comment. So we're talking today about spiritual bread, not physical bread. I'm not sure even the experts can completely say they know what's going on with all of that. And once, you know, we're going to go forward in a few years from now, they'll change everything and say, cut out protein and eat more bread. I don't know. These guys must make up their minds. But as a pastor, not as a dietitian, I can tell you that in your spiritual walk as a believer, you need bread. You need the bread of life. You need Jesus. You need his presence. Jesus said he's the bread of life. He called himself the bread of life, and we need him. And my message title today is simply this, fresh bread, fresh bread. I think by the end of the service, you're probably going to want to run out and buy some fresh bread to eat. But I hope, more importantly, you will be hungry for the things of God and hungry for his presence. And his presence is here for us tonight. I want to say at the end of the service, whatever you need in the presence of God will be available to you because God wants to feed us with his bread. And so bread is the symbolic picture of life. It's symbolic of Jesus. It's symbolic of the presence of God. Bread is symbolic of these things. We read another quote. It says, you all need to stop with this. Bread is not good for you, foolishness. Jesus did not say, I am the broccoli of life. Nor did he say, give us this day our daily kale. Stop. Jesus is life. Jesus is the bread. Bread is life. Give us this day our daily broccoli. Do you know what the world's doing? The world's trying to feed you broccoli. And the world is putting sauce on it, barbecue sauce on the broccoli. So it's you're feeling like you're full, but you're actually being left empty. And we've got to realize that God wants to fill us with real life, with real bread. And broccoli is great for you, but you can't live on it. God wants to give us his bread of life. So let's go back to the Old Testament temple. Let's talk about bread. In the Old Testament temple, remember when the Israelites were walking through the desert, when they were on the move, they set up a tabernacle. When they were established in a city, they would build a temple. And so in the tabernacle and in the temple where God's presence was, in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament, there was a table, and on this table was bread, and the bread was called the bread of the presence. It was also called the show bread, but it was always present on the table in the temple. Exodus 25, verse 30 says, place the bread of the presence on the table to remain before me at all times. This is God speaking instruction. Place the bread of the presence on the table. Leviticus 25, 5-8 says, you must bake 12 loaves of bread from choice flour using 4 quarts of flour for each loaf. Notice they were using flour. It was probably stone ground flour, but it was flour. Place the bread before the Lord on the pure gold table and arrange the loaves in 2 stacks with 6 loaves in each stack. Put some pure frankincense near each stack to serve as a representative offering, a special gift presented to the Lord. Listen to this. Every Sabbath day, once a week, this bread must be laid out before the Lord as a gift from the Israelites. It is an ongoing expression of the eternal covenant. This bread on the table in the temple was an ongoing expression of the eternal covenant. It reminded the Israelites, reminded the priests when they looked at it, that this was an ongoing eternal covenant that God was establishing with his people. Ephesians 1 verse 13 tells us in the new covenant that the Holy Spirit, now not the bread, but the Holy Spirit, is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it. And it struck me, the bread that was laid out in the temple was an ongoing expression of the eternal covenant. In the New Testament, Jesus said, or the word says, that the Holy Spirit is the new bread that is present on the table of our hearts. And the Holy Spirit is the confirmation. It's the guarantee. It's the ongoing expression of the eternal covenant that God has with us, this new covenant that we have with Jesus. The Holy Spirit is that seal. It's the guarantee. Amazing imagery in the Old and New Testament. But this bread of the presence was an important symbol, and it was resting on the table in the temple. One commentary says of the bread, it says, the bread was designed to be a symbol of the full and never failing provision which is made in the church for the spiritual sustenance and refreshment of God's people. This bread reminded of the spiritual sustenance and refreshment for God's people. This showbread, this bread of the presence was brought to completion when it was fulfilled in Jesus. And this bread on the table in the old covenant was pointing towards Jesus. It was symbolically pointing towards Jesus. Because when Jesus came on earth, he was the actual presence of God walking on earth. And when Jesus came to earth, he declared himself to be the bread of life. John 6:35 says, Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. So the old covenant people and the Jewish nation would have been passed down from generations, this understanding of the bread on the table. Now Jesus comes and says, I am the bread of life. I'm the fulfillment of that. I'm the presence of God on earth. John 6, verse 57, a little bit further on, says, as the living Father sent me, Jesus says, and I live because of the Father. So whoever feeds on me, he will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. And so Jesus is the bread of life. He was God's presence on earth. But the story goes a little bit further. And it gets a little bit more exciting, the story of the bread. Because when Jesus returned to the Father, he said, I'm going so that I can send the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit who will come to dwell in us. The Holy Spirit comes and he is now dwelling in us on earth as believers. We carry the presence of God on earth. Jesus said of us, I am in them and they are in me. And we know that we're the ambassadors of Christ. We continue the work of Jesus on the earth. Remember, Jesus was the bread of life. Now, with Jesus back with the Father and the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, who are we? We are the body of Christ, aren't we? We're the body of Christ. So we are now those that the world must eat of, that the world must find and touch God's presence in, because we have the Holy Spirit in us. The very presence of God is dwelling in us. And the very presence of God is resting on the table of our hearts, just like that showbread did. We now have the Holy Spirit in us. It's an amazing thing that the power of God, that the God of the universe through Spirit dwells in us. And we are now the body of Christ. And just in a sense, as Jesus said, come and eat of me and you won't die, we need to break the bread of our lives for the people around us as we share his presence in us with those around us. And we share that with our family, the church family, as we minister to each other, and we share that with the world. And we're going to expand on this whole understanding. If Jesus fed the world with the bread of life, so must we. And he's given us his presence. Remember, the bread represents the presence. Here's the other incredible thing. The 12 loaves, there were 12 loaves of bread. The showbread was made up of 12 loaves sitting on this table. The 12 loaves also represented the 12 tribes of Israel. Remember, the 12 tribes of Israel was Israel. It was the people of God. The bread represented the people. I wonder if this wasn't a prophetic statement of the fact that one day the people would be the bread, that we would be the bread of life to those around us. Because those 12 tribes are represented by bread, we now, the body of Christ, are providing the bread of the presence to the world, the Holy Spirit in us, as we minister to those around us. He left us with a job of providing the bread of his presence to those around us. He left us with a job on earth to help provide spiritual sustenance and refreshment. It's not our power. We're not the bread. Jesus is the bread, but the Holy Spirit in us empowers us to bring life to people around us and bring sustenance and build up and encourage them. Do all the things that physical bread does, but in a spiritual sense. When you pray for someone, when you release a prophetic word, when you have a word of knowledge, when you minister to someone, when you just put your arms around someone, and have you ever had someone hug you and it's like the presence of God is on you? When we do these things, we're feeding people with the bread of his presence. We're being the bread to other people. Now, there's another story of bread in the Old Testament which mirrors what God is doing on earth. And it's found in the life of Joseph. And Genesis 37 to 46 is the account of Joseph. I'm going to summarize these 9 chapters in Genesis. We'd be here all night if we read them, but I'm going to summarize them now. And I want you to stay with me, though, because what I will share now will link back to what I've just shared about us being the bread of life. So stay with me. Let's tell the story of Joseph, the true account of Joseph. Once there was a guy named Joseph, and he had 10 older brothers and one younger brother. And again, many of you have heard this story, but there are many people that are new to the faith, and so I can't always just say like the story you already know, because for some people, they may not know that story. So let's tell the story. So it was Joseph, 10 older brothers, one younger one, and when Joseph was a boy, he was his dad's favorite. In fact, his dad liked Joseph so much better than the other brothers that he gave Joseph a special multicolored coat, a gift to prove his love for Joseph. And this expensive multicolored coat, as you can imagine, and this love, this exceeding love that his father had for him as opposed to his other brothers, made Joseph very unpopular with his brothers. Joseph was not popular. And to make it worse, Joseph did the very clever thing of sharing the dreams that he was getting. Dreams that he would one day rule over his brothers and his father and his mother. And he very wisely shared that with his already jealous brothers and made it worse. And so one day, they're out working in the field and the brothers look at him and say, well, there comes that dreamer again. And they looked at him and they, with anger and hatred in their hearts, they threw their brother Joseph into a dark pit. And they might have left him there forever, but they saw some men traveling to Egypt. And so they sold Joseph as a slave to Egypt. They thought that would be slightly nicer of them than leaving him in a pit to die. So they sold him into slavery. Very kind of them. They went home and told their brothers that Joseph had been killed by a wild animal. And this obviously broke their dad's heart. And these brothers were bad news. Just so that you know, a disclaimer, selling a sibling into slavery is never a good idea. Please don't try this at home. But the Bible says that the Lord was with Joseph. Joseph was a servant and he worked in Potiphar's house. Potiphar was a high-ranking official. And Potiphar liked Joseph so much, was so impressed by Joseph, that he made Joseph in charge of his whole household. Joseph was happy until one day he was blamed for something he didn't do. He was sent to prison on trumped-up charges as Potiphar's wife made advances on him and he backed off because he was a good boy. And he backed off her advances and she was scorned by that. And you know the saying, hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. And she accused him of trying to rape her and he got away. And as he was leaving, she held onto his coat and then she took the coat and said, look, he's trying to rape me. They put him in prison on trumped up charges. Now Joseph's life is going from bad to worse. He was a slave and now he's a prisoner in the dungeons of Egypt, and his life seems to be going downhill. But even in prison, God was with him, and God was favoring Joseph even in prison. The guards in the prison liked Joseph so much, were so impressed by him, they put him in charge of all the other prisoners. And God began to grow Joseph's ability to interpret dreams supernaturally. One day, Pharaoh's cupbearer and Pharaoh's baker, who were also in prison, they have a dream. And Joseph is able to interpret the dream correctly. The cupbearer would be reinstated, and he was. The baker would die, and he died. Exactly as Joseph had said. 2 years later, after this event, Pharaoh had asked them to remember him Joseph had asked the baker and the cupbearer to remember him in the courts of Pharaoh. They forgot about him. The baker forgot about him because he was dead. But the cupbearer forgot about him because he just forgot. And he was obviously so happy he got his job back, he forgot about Joseph. But 2 years later, Pharaoh has a dream and the cupbearer remembers Joseph can interpret dreams. None of the wise men in Egypt can interpret the dream. So they call Joseph out of prison. They shave him, they wash him, they clean him. They bring him up to Pharaoh. And Joseph says that the dream he's having is not a dream, it's actually a nightmare. And Joseph interprets this nightmare. He says that there's a famine coming. There will first be 7 years of plenty, but then there's a famine of 7 years that will follow on from that. And then Joseph, as God gives him supernatural wisdom, says, the way we're going to survive this is we're going to store up food in the 7 good years. And so Pharaoh thinks this idea is brilliant, and Pharaoh puts Joseph in charge of all of Egypt. Joseph becomes second in charge, second only to Pharaoh. He basically becomes the prime minister of Egypt. That's quite a serious, promotion that Joseph gets in a short space of time. So the 7 hungry years come and nobody can eat without getting food from Joseph. Joseph is the bread man. Joseph is the Sasco Sam man. He's the human grain vending machine. Everyone's got to come to Joseph for bread. Joseph provides bread for Egypt, and he provides bread, in fact, for the whole surrounding Egypt region, because the famine is quite severe. Like everybody else, Joseph's brothers eventually come to Egypt looking for food. Who do they have to come and ask but Joseph? And Joseph recognizes them. They don't recognize him. He tests them secretly. There's a whole story about how he tests them to see if they've changed. Remember, they were the ones that threw him in a pit and sold him into slavery. You can't blame the guy for trying to make sure that they had a change of heart. So he checks them out, and then when he can take it no more, he says, I'm your brother, I'm the one you sold. And Joseph forgives them, and he says, what you planned for harm, my brothers, God turned into good. And I'm able to now save Egypt and save you, save my family because of what has happened. God turned it around for good. And so this is important. Joseph provides bread for Egypt, and Joseph provides bread to his family. Joseph became the new baker. While Joseph was in prison, we just spoke about how he had correctly interpreted the dreams of Pharaoh's cupbearer and Pharaoh's baker. The cupbearer was restored to his position and the baker died. It's interesting to me that the baker died. It almost feels like it was a prophetic statement that God was clearing the way. As the baker died, he was clearing the way for a new baker to arrive, because the new baker was coming. A new provider of bread to Egypt was coming. Joseph was about to become Egypt's bread provider. There are many parallels between Joseph and Jesus, in fact. We started off talking about how Jesus is the bread of life. There are many, many parallels, over 100 parallels between Jesus and Joseph. It's fascinating. But the one we want to pick up today, the one that God showed me that has just blown my mind, is how Joseph and Jesus both became bread providers, providers of life. Through the sin of his brothers, Joseph was sown from his comfortable place in his family. He was sold into slavery, sold for 20 pieces of silver. So he leaves this comfortable place with his family, and Joseph is sown into a very uncomfortable place in Egypt. And in Egypt, he's as good as dead and buried in the dungeons of Egypt. And then God, through his supernatural power, through the interpretation of the dream, it was the Holy Spirit on Joseph, the power that was on Joseph, causes him to interpret the dream and rise up, be almost resurrected from the dungeons, and becomes someone who moves from the dungeons into the palace, and he becomes the prime minister of Egypt, and he stores up the grain, and he's later becomes the provider of bread for his brothers. He saves his brothers, and he saves Egypt. This is the story of Joseph. This is the story of Jesus hundreds of years later. Through the sin of his brothers, us, Jesus is sown by the Father from his comfortable place in heaven into Egypt, this lost world. Jesus is sown. The Son of Heaven is sown into this Egypt, into this lost world. Jesus was also sown for pieces of silver. He was also betrayed and crucified by his Jewish brothers. Many parallels. And Jesus was dead and buried in a tomb, not symbolically like Joseph was. Jesus was actually buried in a tomb. And then through the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus is raised up to life, and God resurrects him. And while he's on earth, we know Jesus was called the bread of life. John 6:35 says, I'm the bread of life. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. The whole world had to go to Joseph for bread. The whole world is now coming to Jesus for the bread of life. He's the provider of bread. There was a new baker in town. His name was Jesus. So like Joseph, Jesus fed people with the bread of life. And he fed first his fellow Jews in that sense, because Jesus came for the Jews, and then he also came for the Gentiles. That's Egypt. So Jesus came for his family, and Jesus came for what became the Gentiles, who also brought into this family of God, and that's us in Egypt. So Jesus came for both of those. He was the provider of bread. But the story gets more exciting, because Jesus returned to the Father so that he could send the promised Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit has come to dwell inside of us. And now we become those who feed each other with the bread of his presence, and we feed the world with the bread of his presence. There are new bakers in town. It's us. We have a job to do. And that prophetic story has continued right to us. We have become the new bakers. We are the new providers of bread. We are meant to be bread dispensers. We are made to be walking, talking, bread vending machines of the presence of God. Isn't that exciting? And we get to do that with each other. So you get to be blessed by the bread of His presence that someone provides for you just when you need that word of knowledge that comes just as you need it. You get to be that. And you get to be the bread dispensing machine, and you get to receive the blessing of the bread as your brothers and sisters around you operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And the worship team, when they operate in their gifts, they are bread dispensers of His presence. And when someone shares from the stage, it's bread dispensing. The bread of His presence comes as the word is preached. And you know what the exciting thing is? It happens at every level. I had such an exciting story. I heard such an exciting story at KLS about someone, we don't know who they are, but this person shared the testimony about how someone in this church brought a word, a scripture. They said, go and read this passage of scripture. This person, now this was a prophetic thing that someone laid on someone's heart and said, this is a word of knowledge. Read this passage of scripture. It will change your life. This person did it in probably with their knees shaking, not knowing what was going to happen. Do you know that that guy went home and read the scripture that that person gave him, and it changed his life upside down? It took him from a place of brokenness and turned his life upside down and his family's life upside down, because one person dispensed bread, the bread of life, to someone, and as they ate that, their life was changed. This is exciting. We get to be bread dispensers and we get to receive the bread. And the bread that we're given is not just for us. It is for us. Remember, the bread was for the family of God and it was for Egypt. The bread that we carry is for us as a family to feed us, but it's bread that we're also able to feed the world with. And the smell of fresh bread is all over us. It must be all over us because the world is hungry. The world is hungry. And we are called to be those that provide bread. Whenever God wants to do something, let me say, when God wants to do something, what does He do? He sows a son and a daughter. Egypt was a powerful nation, but God placed something even bigger inside Joseph. God filled Joseph with His Holy Spirit, sowed him into Egypt, and Joseph fulfilled his redemptive purpose. In Egypt, it was the power of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God that allowed Joseph to interpret Pharaoh's dream. He rose up to the palace. He acted on the interpretation of the dream, stored up grain, and ultimately saved the nation of Israel. His brothers were the nation of Israel. They grew into the 12 tribes of Israel. Joseph saved them. He saved the family of God at that time, and he saved Egypt, the surrounding Egypt and the surrounding regions. Nothing's changed. We live in a big, scary world, and once again, God has sown us all over the show into our Egypt, and He's left us alone. He hasn't left us alone. He's given us the Holy Spirit. He placed the Holy Spirit to dwell inside of us, and He's given us that Holy Spirit and sown us into Egypt. Why has He done that? Why has He done that? Because He wants bread in Egypt again. Jesus wants bread in your Egypt, and He wants you to bring bread to that Egypt, and He wants bread in this house, in the family of God, and you're going to be the bread of His presence to those around you. The world is hungry, guys. The world is hungry. The world doesn't know it, but the world is hungry. They're missing something. The broccoli with barbecue sauce on it is not satisfying them. The world's offering something that's hollow, and they're hungry for bread, and we've got the bread of life. It's found in Jesus, and He's sown us into Egypt to provide that bread, and He wants us to find bread here too as we gather here on Sunday and in our connect groups in the places and spaces we find ourselves. The presence of God, the bread of God, is here for Egypt and is here for the family of God. I'm going to close out with this. I opened up in the beginning sharing about this bread of the presence on the table in the temple. That was always present. The bread was always present. It had to be present on the temple table. In the New Testament, the temple is us. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus wants this bread of His presence to always be present in our temples on the table of our hearts. God wants us to always have fresh bread on the table of our hearts. That's why I shared last week about us regularly praying for a fresh and filling of the Holy Spirit. Keep on being filled with the Spirit. Why? Because God wants fresh bread on our table every week. He wants fresh bread. We need to share this bread and break the bread. Here's the exciting thing about fresh bread. It goes back to that Old Testament table. That once a week on the Sabbath, the priests would eat the old bread. They would get rid of the old bread, and then they would put freshly baked bread on the temple for the week ahead, on the table. So there was always a smell of fresh bread in the temple, and there was always fresh bread on the table. That was what God required. And God wants us always to be in a place where we are getting rid of the stale bread and we're placing fresh bread on our table. We're getting rid of the things that make our life stale and we're saying, Holy Spirit, fill me afresh. Fall afresh on me. Let there be fresh bread on our table. And as we operate in the supernatural gifts, as we have words of knowledge, words of wisdom, as we release the gift, as we just pray for healing for someone, or just pray a prayer of encouragement, using a gift of encouragement that God has given us, as we do that, we're dispensing bread and we're sharing the bread of His presence with our brothers and sisters. And then the smell of this fresh bread must draw the lost to us. When people walk into this church, I want them to smell freshly baked bread. That must make them hungry. And when we walk out, the scent of the fresh bread must be left as residue on our clothes. And as we walk into the world, into our Egypt, they must smell the bread and be attracted to it. Genesis 42, Jacob said to his sons, around about this time, he says, why are you looking at each other, sons? Why are you looking at each other? Get down to Egypt. There's bread in Egypt. Naomi in Moab heard that there was bread in Israel, and then she said, it's time to go home. There's bread in Israel. I believe God is saying that every week, I've got fresh bread for you, fresh bread of my presence for you here in your connect groups, in your quiet times. Eat the bread. Receive the bread. Go and run to where you find that bread, because God says, I've prepared a table for you. There's fresh bread in this house. And there's been a lot over the years about making church seeker sensitive. And there are certain things the scripture speaks about, and we must adhere to them so we don't chase seekers away. People seeking Jesus, the lost. But we worship with abandon here still. And we allow the Holy Spirit to have His way. We invite the Holy Spirit to have His way here. Why? Because the lost need the presence of God. That's what they came here for. They came for the presence of God. They came not to eat spiritual broccoli. They came to receive the bread of life. And there's bread in the temple. The lack of bread, these spiritual low-carb diets that people have out in the world, is making them hungry for bread. The emptiness in the things of the world is making people hungry for the bread of the presence of God. There are a lot of people craving freshly baked bread out there. We have bread in the house.